your word tonight in the same fashion that we just sang, God, that you really are the way maker, Father, that you're above anything we could ever comprehend, God, that you still have our interests in mind somehow, Father. So we want to lean into that, God. This isn't just some generic word, Father, to make people better. This is a personal word, God, to speak into our situation. So I just pray over Ryan. I pray over your word, God. Get real tonight, Father, to each person in the room, old and young. We're here for you, God. And we want to believe that you have our interests in mind. Thank you, Jesus, for tonight. Build Interstate up, not in numbers even, but in spirit, Father, that we could just come in here and completely shine our lights, God, that this place would be illuminated, Father, with your spirit, with your love. People would come in here and just be changed. You would come into this room and just be changed because of the love that we have for each other and for you. That is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. That was awesome. You may be seated, and we got our summer camp speaker back again. Nothing but mean things to Mrs. Reamer at home. Alright?
be like, Mr. Reamer, I didn't even know he was that kind of stuff. It's kind of hard to think about all the positive things you know about me if you know one really, really bad thing, right? And this is challenging just in life to come to terms with the fact that for many of us, the negative can overwhelm us. Because not only is it easy to remember, sometimes our minds run with the story, right? Do you guys know what it means to ruminate? Ooh, we're gonna learn a new word! Oh, it's so big. I have a bunch of words just in case you guys knew some of them already that I have planned to teach you. Ruminate. Ruminate is when you overthink, right? It's when the negative plays in your head all day. For example, classroom management, professional development classes. And these professional people that write their fancy books and have big degrees behind their name say that if you're trying to reinforce something with a kid, you gotta stay there for like 12 seconds and keep talking about it. In other words, if Luke did something right, I'm gonna say, Luke, thank you for leading our hearts in that worship. I can tell that you really put some time and energy into that. And you must have planned a long time to sing that song and practice forever. And plus, I really appreciated how in tune you were with us, that you were listening for us and you were hoping that we would get to experience the worship of a good God together. Thank you for doing that. Luke is more likely to remember that I'm thankful and more likely to remember the positive reinforcement that he got if I stay there for at least 12 seconds. Right? There's some other cool factors that have nothing to do with my topic tonight. But the more we can dwell on positive things, the better. This is what our research is telling us. A lot of brain science is pointing to ways to get our mind in a positive state, because so many people are so sad and down and depressed. Because even though there's no shortage of things to be excited about, there's also no shortage of things that we can mourn and dwell on, be stressed about, and frustrated. The most negative I get, I'll just tell you my own personal struggles, is just the stress of managing lots of things at once and not being that like type A, super organized person. And because of that, I fly by the seat of my pants about 90% of the time. What I love doing, and this isn't part of what I love doing, is waking up and silent in my house and spending time reading this book and taking copious notes. I fill up notebook after notebook after notebook. A fresh notebook is like the greatest gift anybody can ever give me. I love doing that. I love thinking about that stuff because it's the thing that keeps me positive, right? It's the thing that I look forward to talking about. I get excited when I learn new things, and I get really excited when I can share new things. My verse tonight is written by somebody who had no shortage of stress in his life. Okay? I'm going to be reading a verse, two verses actually, from Philippians chapter 4. And I want you to know that the man who wrote Philippians, the letter to this church in Philippi, he was not in Disneyland, as it might sound. He was actually in prison when he wrote it. This was somebody who, if he would just shut up about Jesus, he would not have gotten beaten multiple times and disciplined by the government. He would not have been thrown in prison. He would not have been shipwrecked. He would not have been rejected by person after person after person. Nobody would slander his name. Everybody would say good things about him because he used to be this respected political academic guy. Used to be really, and he studied under a prestigious teacher. He really did have it pretty good until he started following Jesus. And then, according to him, he had it better. But he also had to deal with all of these other things that stressed him out. He says, I didn't run the numbers on this, but talks about joy and